this theme that we're preaching today is exactly what made this ministry what it is today. For 21 years, we did this, we implemented this, we personified this, we set the example, we set the tone, and many churches around this state and other states that I got opportunity to preach with were very encouraged that our type of Christianity, how we perceive things, how we live, what we do in our ministry here is a blessing to them, and that we became an example to them. And so if we look real quickly here in Luke chapter 7, I want to start in verse 34, because Luke chapter 7, starting in verse 34, we'll read right down to the very end to kind of get things in context. As you turn there, I want you to understand here, the Lord Jesus Christ was dealing with the religious crowd, those Pharisees, you know, those darn Pharisees that are so critical and self-righteous and religious in their own right, looking down at everything, questioning everything, and challenging the Lord Jesus Christ if he was the prophet, if he was really the man of God, if he really was the anointed, all that kind of stuff, doing all kinds of miracles, doing all kinds of things to be a blessing. And it comes to this point of the chapter here where I want to try to get it in context. I want you to notice his heart. I want you to notice his direction. I want you to notice what he's going to be doing, what he has been done all along with his ministry on earth for 3.5 years, his essence. Okay? So here in Luke chapter 7, if you could, look at verse 34. And it says this, the Son of Man has come eating and drinking, and ye say, behold, a gluttonous man and a winebibber, a friend of publicans and what? Sinners. So he was accused of a lot, wasn't he? Right? He was accused of hanging out with the wrong crowd. But can I tell you, that's our crowd. The gluttonous, the wine bibbers, right? And publicans and sinners. And look, he's being accused of that. That's a pretty good accusation, amen to me? That's okay with me. Because we're going to look at today's message. We're going to see how it fits with some other Christians and some other preachers, okay? But it says here in verse 35, but wisdom is justified for all her children. And one of the Pharisees desired him that he would eat with him. And he went into the Pharisee's house and sat down to meat. And behold, a woman in the city, which was a what? When she knew that Jesus sat and meat with the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment, and stood at his feet behind him, weeping, and began to wash his feet with tears, and did wipe them with the hairs of her head, and kissed his feet, and anointed them with the ointment. Now when the Pharisee, which had bidden him, saw it, he spake with himself, saying, this man, if we were a prophet, he would have known who and what manner of woman this is that touches him, for she is a what? Sinner. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Simon, I have somewhat to say unto thee. And he said, Master, say, huh? There was a certain creditor which had two debtors, and one owed him 500 pence, and the other 50. And when they had nothing to pay, he frankly forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love him the most? Simon answered and said, I suppose that he to whom he forgave most. And he said unto him, thou hast rightly judged. And he turned to the woman and said unto Simon, seest thou this woman? I entered into thine house. Thou gavest me no water for my feet, but she hath washed my feet with tears and wiped them with the hairs of her head. Thou gavest me no kiss, but this woman, since the time I came in, hath not ceased to kiss my feet. My head with oil thou didst not anoint, but this woman hath anointed my feet with ointment. Wherefore I say unto thee, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loveth a little. And he said unto her, thy sins are forgiven. And they saw, and they that sat at meat with him began to say within themselves, who is this that forgiveth sins also? And he said to the woman, thy faith has saved thee. Go in peace. Now there's a lot there, but I did it all for the kind of get you to understand the setting here, okay? There is a perception with the religious crowd, is there not? There's a reception with those publicans, with the Pharisees, with the religious crowd, when they look at a sinner compared to how Jesus sees things. Okay? I'm not preaching about the woman with the alabaster box, even though we're going to talk a little bit about that, because that's one of the points. But I want you to focus on Jesus, how Jesus sees things. The setting here, you have a religious crowd, okay? And I'm going to be honest with you, good Christian churches become religious, which is a danger, because they start getting pharisaical. And they move away from the essence of how Jesus would do things, and how Jesus looks at things, and how Jesus deals with sinners. So I don't want to go that direction, amen? Does anybody here want to go that direction? Like a religious person? Don't go religious on me now. Go Christ-like on me. That's what I want you to be. I want you to be Christ-like. And so here you see the setting. All this religious crowd, they see this woman coming to the scene, and they go, oh, that's a sinner. You know how she is and what she's done, all the sins that she's done. And that religious crowd is trying to provoke Jesus to be like them, when Jesus is going to be like God. Amen. We reflect this Heavenly Father. And so you sit there and you see this. I want you to notice here that when God looks at the world and sees a whole field of sinners that are out here in the world, you got to remember some of the things that he tried to encourage with his disciples, to his apostles, his preachers. And in Mark chapter 16, 15, he says, go preach the gospel to every creature. Right? To every creature. And there's a lot of creatures out there, amen? There's big creatures, there's small creatures, there's ugly creatures, there's smelly creatures. All kinds of creatures out there that need to hear the gospel. There's creatures that are full of sin, and sin has engulfed them, and they don't look appealing. They're hurting. They're damaged. But Jesus says, go preach to every creature. Now, another verse in the Bible, in Luke chapter 19, verse 10, he came to seek and to save which is lost. Right? Jesus himself set the example. I came here to go seek after all those that are lost. He didn't come here to save people. He came here to save sinners. Amen. And then in Matthew chapter 9, verse 13, Jesus came here again. He said this. He came to reach sinners to repent. John the Baptist kind of, as a forerunner, kind of did that. Remember? He says, repent ye. He came out there and set the example. That's why they had a hard time. And go, is he greater than John the Baptist? That same message I heard from John the Baptist, this guy's talking about too. Well, yeah, because he's the Messiah. John the Baptist getting you ready to listen to the same message to show that everybody's in line with God. And he says he wants sinners to repent. Repentance is something you're turning away from the falsehood. You're turning away from your sin. Turn away from how you think our things are. And you're turning to Jesus, the one who wants to save your soul. So you see it all through the Bible. There's three things I want to share with you this morning. I want you to look at it through God's eyes. I want you to look how Jesus did look at it through his eyes when it came to this situation. How he looked at this woman. How he looked at this sinner. Key word. How Jesus looked at this sinner. If you go back real quick to verse 44 here in chapter 7. Turn over there to verse. We'll start in verse 44. When you get there, put your finger there. So I'm going to pray real quick. Ask God's blessing on the message. Still fighting off my allergies. I'm sorry. Let's pray. Father, again, thank you so much for this message. I pray that the Holy Spirit will take it, touch hearts, get our minds and our hearts knit with you, how we perceive and how we see things that need to be done in your sight when it comes to being a friend to sinners and giving that beautiful gospel message to sinners to be saved and repent and turn to you, Lord. Bless this message. In Jesus' name, amen. You get all kinds of Christians out there. Of course, one of the ones that come to mind all the time is that Westboro Baptist Church, right? Boy, they just hate everything. Everything's hate about them. There's not one good thing that comes out of those people's mouth at all. And the sad thing about it, they carried on the legacy with the man that headed it all up, that died a few years back. They're still continuing on that poison, that toxin, okay? Then you got some of these Baptist churches that go around here, they're so separated, they're no longer separated, they're isolated. They insulated their church, and you cannot, anybody beyond their realm of their own, quote unquote, they won't even let a sinner walk in the doors. But you're losing the essence of us. Here, it's amazing here how Jesus was accused of being a friend of sinners. So we need to really look at it, Baptist or not, Bible church or not, or just a church, whatever. We need to see what Jesus looks at, through God's eyes, how he sees things. And I'm going to tell you this morning, we're so far removed from the truth when it comes to living the Christian life that we need to get back to the basics, amen? Amen. And this ministry is down to the back to the basics. it's one of the greatest things that really hurt my soul was that when we started 21 years ago, Charity Mission, it was us on the street. We were on the streets. We dealt with sinners face to face. We dealt with the homeless. And because we became the church to get the church to the city, folks, we couldn't do it all. Amen? But we're introducing little by little. We kept the Tuesday night going, right? We're getting ready for the mobile mission. Some of you are already interested in helping Brother Mike Southward with the mobile mission. Go up to the service, tell them about all that. We're getting ready to go introduce ourselves back to the Harbor House to try to find out what days are available to do this ministry. Amen? And get in there and minister their souls with the gospel, with John and Romans, with a little bit of love of hats and gloves and maybe a pot full of chili. Befriending them. You can't befriend sinners. You're gonna get contaminated. What are you talking about? We're already contaminated. If it wasn't for Jesus, you know what I'm saying? We have to deal with sin every day in our life, don't we not? But we just dress up pretty good. You know, we get our hairdo all done, and you know, we cover up with some nice clothes with a tie and shirt and look like a Howl's Answer crowd, right? Yes, we make sure you write that down. Look like a Howl's Answer crowd and a Rockwood crowd. We get to play church real good and look all nice. And then we go, hey, listen, let's just get real. Amen? Jesus was right there with a sinner, a woman that everybody knew many of her sins in the whole entire area. She had a reputation of being a sinner. And here, we need to look it through God's eyes. Here in verse 44, look at this. Verse 44, Jesus says this, and he turned to the woman and said unto Simon, seest thou this woman? So he's trying to teach Simon, look at now, a teaching. He's teaching him here. He goes, I entered into thine house, thou givest me no water for my feet. Thou gavest no water for people, but she hath washed my feet with tears and wiped them with the hairs of her head. Thou gavest me no kiss, but this woman, since the time I came in, hath not ceased to kiss my feet. My head with oil thou didst not anoint, but this woman hath anointed my feet with ointment. And she goes on and says, wherefore I say unto thee, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loveth a little. For he said unto her, thy sins are forgiven. And they that sat at meat with him began to say within themselves, who is this that forgiveth sins also? People that are gathering around, when he invited them in that house, the religious house, and they eat, they're sitting there going, wait a minute, this guy was just eating with us. And now he's turned into a sinner. And we know how wicked she is. We know all her sins. And he's trying to teach us. Listen, we can learn a lot from sinners, can we not? You know some things we can learn about sinners? Remind us where we came from.
Amen.
How deep we were deceived. How big we were blind. The price that we paid. Amen. And then the point. I want to get a point here across is how much she understands God's love and forgiveness, and what she recognizes with her. It goes on a little bit further here. It goes on here in verse 50, and he said to the woman, thy faith has saved thee, go in peace. So this woman had three things going for her. Number one, her love. Her love. You see, then you saw that right here in verse 47, her sins which are many are forgiven, but for she loved much. Amen? She loved much. She demonstrated with her life how much she loved the Lord Jesus Christ. Can I tell you right now? His love is unconditional. Amen?
Amen.
So listen, we need to love him unconditionally. Many times as Christians, we put stipulations on God. We don't even know it. Lord, if you don't bless me with this, I am not going to church. Well, that's not the reason why you go to church. Well, if you don't answer my prayer, but because you know I love you, I did all this for you, and your name's sake, you should be blessing me. No, he should not be blessing you. We don't need to put conditions on God. We just need to do what we need to do because we love him and obey him. Amen?
Amen.
There's no condition with God. We don't put Monty Hall with God. You don't sit there and I'll do this for that. That's religion. But a true Christian sister says, Lord, I know you died for me on that cross. You showed everything you did for me. Now it's my turn to love you back. Amen?
Yeah.
Love you back. And for the sake of time, in Luke chapter 10, verse 27, let's turn it real quick. So I cut that in the same the same books. We can just turn the page a little bit here. But in Luke chapter 10, if you could, Luke chapter 10, a familiar verse that was written back in Deuteronomy, right? Luke chapter 10, and it says this in verse 27. Luke chapter 10 and verse 27, it says, "And he answered and said, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy strength, amen, and with all thy mind, and thy neighbor as thyself." That's the whole, that covers everything, don't it? That means your whole entire being, we need to love him back. Why? Because he put his whole entire being on the cross for you and I. I want, this morning, I want to tell you that you need to start seeing things through God's eyes. That love was sacrificial. That love was all in all. It was his whole entire being. Because he paid the price with that sacrifice. He did everything he could for you to have eternal life. And to show you his love with a demonstration of laying his life on that cross of Calvary. Amen? Amen. She understood that. That's why she did everything she could to show and express and display her love to our Savior. By wiping his feet with the tears and with her hair. To going ahead and not only that, but also going ahead and putting ointment. Loving much. She came back and loved him much. Not only that, but she understood about forgiveness, right? You understand we've been forgiven? And that blood that's still available to wash away our sins, every time we go back and we mess up with God, we sin against our God, we can get on our knees and ask God for forgiveness. We don't have to get saved again, but boy, when we mess up, it's praise the Lord, we can get on our knees, we can bow and humble ourselves before the feet of Jesus and say, "Lord, forgive me, I failed, I fell short, I fell in temptation, I sinned against you." And he can take that blood and wash it right away and forgive you and toss it as far as east to the west. And it's forgotten. It's gone. It's forgotten. It's forgotten. She understood that forgiveness. Turn over to 2 John real quick. 2 John, I believe it is. I hope it is. 2 John. Hope I wrote that right down. No, it's in 1 John. Sorry. 1 John. See? Woo-woo. 1 John chapter 2. 1 John. So this woman had love, and this woman has forgiveness, amen? She understood that forgiveness, and now she gave her whole entire life to the Lord. Here in 1 John chapter 2, if you look at verse 8, and again, a new commandment I write unto you, which thing is true in him and in you. Because the darkness is past, and the true light now shineth. He that saith he is in the light, and hateth his brother, is in darkness even until now. He that loveth his brother abideth in the light, and there is no occasion of stumbling in him. In verse 11, and he that hateth his brother is in darkness, and walketh in darkness, and knoweth not whither he goeth, because the darkness hath blinded his eyes. I write unto you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah! Right? Forgiven. We remember when we were in darkness, when we're trapped in darkness, when we're doing what we were trapped in it, right? Now we're in the light, and we need to walk in the light. So guess what? When we finally get a chance to go ahead and understand what forgiveness is all about, things that happen here in the church and out there in the street when you're dealing with sinners should not easily offend us at all. Amen?
Yeah.
Remember the Lord Jesus Christ, when he was on the cross, he was ready to give up the ghost. He said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they what?
Do."
Sin is sin, right? People do fool. They chase the sin. They live in the sin. They're blinded. They don't even know they're sinning until you approach them and deal with them, right? And show them the goodness of God. And show them how Christ died for the love. How he died for the sins of the world. This woman understood. And here, look at, and Jesus took Simon over and said, "Look at this woman." He wanted Simon to see things through his eyes. Let me ask you a question this morning. Do you see things through God's eyes? This lady also had faith. See verse 50 there, Luke chapter 7. Her thy faith was recognized by the Lord Jesus Christ. So even a sinner does have faith. lot of people sit there, and when I talk to, when I sit there and witness to sinners, they say, well, I got faith. I go, you do? I go, in what? I want to hear from her, them. Him or her, I want to hear it. Well, I got faith. We got faith in. And you hear all kinds of crazy stuff. But when you sit there and hear, I have faith in God, I go, you do? I go, how? If I don't hear about how they accepted Christ in their heart, then they didn't get it. They got religious, the religious version of stuff, right? When it came into maybe a religious way, how they were taught, how, you know, every so often I see, you know, I see on TV, and I believe. You're, I believe in God. You do, you believe in God, but do you live for God? Do you understand what God's done? You ever hear of a man called the Lord Jesus Christ? Those type of things. Because that's where it all starts. So that faith has to be identified. In Luke chapter 5 and verse 20. Just turn the page over. Luke chapter 5, verse 20. And the Lord's going around healing people again, trying to show himself that he is the anointed one. And here, he does it again. And the Pharisees are watching. Now listen to this. He goes on and says, and when he saw their faith, come on, all the ones that had palsy and everything else, and they brought him in the inn and lay him down there, and the Pharisees are all watching this, and he sits there, and when he saw their faith, he said unto him, man, thy sins are forgiven. The man had enough faith in the Lord Jesus Christ to heal him up, take care of him. And look at the next verse, 21. And the scribes and the Pharisees began to reason, saying, who is this which speaketh blasphemy? Who can forgive sins but God alone? Because they had no faith. Right? Because they had no faith. But they did have a structured religion. They had a religion that was structured. That they followed by doing the duties of that structure. Those laws and those commandments. That they'd be okay. God will accept them and receive them for all their obedience according to law. But they're missing the business. They're missing the action of love. They're missing the action of forgiveness. They're missing the action of what true faith is and putting it into him. Not into do's and don'ts. Amen? Very key to that thing. We need to be friends of sinners. Many times I hate to say it this morning, that we sit there, we think that we're okay, that we're religious, that we're all right, if we just obey God and do it and stay out of trouble. Listen, I'd rather you love Jesus, I'd rather you do what you got to do for the Lord and fail 100 times, but love sinners and fail 100 times because your heart's in the right where? It's fixed on God. Amen? And you're letting God work on you. You're not letting some church dogma, some man beat you down and say, you need to get a haircut. You need to use deodorant. Right? You need to read 20 chapters this week or else you're not a member any longer. You know? Stupid stuff like that. But it happens. You got to wear a white shirt all the time in church because that's where I come from. I'm just telling you, be careful. Right? I want to tell you this morning, we need to see things through God's eyes. I also want you to help you a little bit here. I want you to look at God's landscape. What do you mean? I've heard preachers tell me before that ideal what goes on within the four walls, ready for this one? In my church. Key word, my church. Okay, I love that. My church. When's God going to get fat? I usually, when's God going to get fat? You know, but they don't want me at pastor. Listen, they're inviting me on Columbus Day to go to a pastor's fellowship. I might lose my support. I don't know if I'm going to keep it any longer after that day. Because we have all those pastors there. They don't want them. There's some of them that are going to be there that rubbed me the wrong way, you know? You ever eat a piece of pie and there's like something in it and you don't want to be in it? That's kind of like me at pastor's fellowship. It looks so good on the outside, but once I get in and start digging in, you find that nasty piece in there that you don't like. You know what I mean? So, but they invited me. They want me there. I go, okay, you sure you want me there? Okay. And I got to go. So, all right. Well, whoever's driving me to that, make sure we're done. If I get kicked out, let's go. We'll find somewhere else to eat, okay? So anyways, here, God's landscape. In 2 Corinthians 4:4, who is the God of this world? Thank you, Satan. And welcome to your landscape. For God so loved the what? The world. So God loved the world that the devil's running and influencing and tempting and planting evil seed and manipulating and deceiving and blinding people, right? And that's our landscape. That's our field. A whole bunch of what?
Sinners.
Sinners that are deceived. And it's our job to go do what? Now listen, I hear all the time, I can't wait until we get out of this world. We're going to heaven when we die. I can't wait to get out. And I agree with you 100%. But since we're here, we got to occupy. Right? Not just occupy the chair. We got not just occupying time. We got to occupy the task at hand. We got to occupy and do what we're made out to do as Christians. We are ambassadors, amen?
Amen?
We represent heaven. We represent the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We are the light. We need to send the light. We need to be that light in the dark world that the devil's running the whole gamut, amen? We need to be that salt, that fresh. I have even told, I have lost people saying at work, saying, wow, your ministry is strange, but boy, it's beautiful. We are strangely beautiful. Yes, peculiar. We are strangely beautiful. What do you mean? Like ugly? He goes, no, it's that I've never heard of a church do so much like that. I take that as a compliment. I don't take that as an insult, right? Because who he is who he is. That's what God made this ministry the way it is. But can I tell you this morning, you and I, we need to understand our landscape. Turn over real quick and put the 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3. And then I'll get to my last point. 1 John chapter 3 has got to show a couple verses here. I know it's hot. I know we're melting. I told you before, summertime. We here at Charity Ventures got the best weight loss clinic ever, amen? You want to lose weight, come to Charity on a Sunday morning, hallelujah. You'll lose weight, and lose weight. We sweat for Jesus on every Sunday morning at Charity Baptist, amen? 1 John, if you could, in chapter 3, and look at verse 13, if you could. Marvel not, my brethren. If the world hate you, guess what? We know that we have passed from death. Wait, we know if the world hate. Can I tell you? Remember that, my brother, if the world hates you. Now, I want to go and show you something real quick. Let's go to John chapter 15, because he's talking about something here. He refers something in John chapter 15. So look, when people start hating you, when you talk about Jesus, can I tell you something real quick here? We were talking about God. I love sitting when I work, we gather up and we help unload all the buses of all our folks. And I always hear a couple comments from a couple people. They sit there and say, yeah, remember that person? He goes, yeah, I like when he was such a great person, but the one thing I didn't like about it is he always talked about God. And about that Jesus. She goes, you know, Jesus was a Jew, you know, because she's Jewish. I go, no kidding. I didn't know it. Thank you. I didn't know that, you know. She's Jewish, telling me that Jesus was a Jew. I go, I know that. And he was the Messiah too. I got to plug that last piece in there, you know what I mean? But the whole thing is this, is that we know all that, right? And the thing is that people, when you mention the word Jesus, watch how they rage. But you mention the word Muhammad, and there's no big, it's like no big deal. Oh, yeah. I'll be honest with you. When you mention Jehovah, which is basically a thing that's through Jehovah's Witness, you hear no cringing. But when you mention a name called Jesus, there's a cringing goes on. I don't know what it is, but it's like embedded in us, the sinners in us, that they want to don't want nothing to do with that name, nothing to do with that title of a person, the Lord Jesus Christ, but they have no problem accepting Muhammad, no problem accepting the word Jehovah when it comes to Jehovah's Witness, none of that stuff. Just try it out at work. Tell me what you think. Try it out amongst your family. See what they think. Try it amongst your neighbors. Watch what they do. But I'm trying to tell you, marvel not. Look at John chapter 15, look at verse 11. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. So the Lord wants to give us some joy, amen? This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his what? Friend. And if we're going to be friends of sinners, you know, you might have to sacrifice something. You might have to give up something. Look up here. In this ministry called Charity Baptist Church, we used to have a place called Charity Mission that used to house God. There was times I had to leave my house at 3 o'clock in the morning because one of the sheep was astray. And I had to go find him.
Amen.
And drag him out. And drag him in. And say, I'll deal with you after work. Go home! Lay down for 2 more hours before I had to wake up to go to where? Work. And get a big mug of coffee to carry on the day. Sometimes when you're dealing with sinners, it's going to cost you something. But can I tell you, someone else is a friend of sinners and it cost him something. Amen?
Amen.
Problem is, we don't want to get burned no more. Problem is, we don't want to be taken advantage of no more. But you know what? There's someone else they got taken advantage of. A lot of people shared, like, remember all those miracles that the Lord Jesus Christ did? Did a lot of sinners get the benefit of all his miracles? Yes or no?
Yes.
Did they all get saved?
No.
We do so much in this church, right? To help out the needy, correct? But can I tell you something? Can I tell you something? Does everybody get saved?
No.
Is the church being filled up? Is the church being filled up? No, it's not. We need to pray that God continue works on the hearts of new people and everything else. Pray. Because God can do a work. Here, Jesus understood all that. He knew the landscape. He knew in this world what he was going to do. He was going to be a friend that lays life for, you know, ye are my friends if you do whatever I command you. Henceforth, I call you not servants, but a servant knoweth what his Lord doeth. And I have called you friends. For all things I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. He goes on here in verse 16. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that ye should go and bring forth fruit, that your fruit should remain, and that whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things I command you, that ye love one another. Look at now, verse 18. If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. And if you were of the world would love his own. But because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. Did you get that? When you got saved and born again, this world is not your what? You have the world, you have another world that you're going to. Your eyes are set on heaven, things above, amen? You're affected on heaven. This world is, this is temporary for you. Life is but a vapor. Don't plant too long here. Because once you leave, you got a whole mansion waiting. That's why when God chooses you to do something great for God, you know what? I'm not saying you can't, you know, give up your home. There's some crazy people out there. Come to the combine. We got a whole, you know, like Lilydale down in Casadega. People, they sell their homes and go down there to be part of their religion. That's crazy. Remember Waco, Texas?
Mm-hmm.
Somebody that go to the combine. Listen, we're not, this is not no cult, okay? But can I tell you this? Look at it. Don't. Disappointments down here are going to come. You're going to try to love your family members and tell them about Jesus, and they're going to sit there and foam at the mouth and scream at you and curse at you. Welcome to Christianity. Welcome to the landscape. Remember, Jesus got crucified when he tried to show his love to the whole world. Tried to befriend the sinners. But you know what? The Lord found one, a woman, that saw a love that was reciprocated back to her and him. Amen? Saw and understood that she can definitely understand forgiveness because of where she came from. And also saw that woman understand that her faith was, had faith in him that she got forgiven and she got great peace for it. Hey, that's the landscape you got to deal with. That's why, look at, as a Christian, it ain't all lilies and beautiful flowers and great smells and oh, God love, you know, kind of stuff. You know, dancing in the green pasture. Because you're going to come along a wolf. You're going to be going ahead and dealing with some stuff. You're going to, part of Christianity is a battle, is it not? We're soldiers in the Lord's army. There's going to be some fights, but there's also some times to embrace and enjoy God's love and God's goodness. Amen? There's a balance in all that. Can I tell you lastly this? What about you? What about me? What do we need to understand here from this scripture right here in Luke chapter 7? When Jesus was a friend of sinners, he was accused. That's good, because I've been accused a lot, too. Over the years, opposition, I had pastors in church tell me, you're never going to make it in the city. But yet they want a church in the city. I'm like, huh? So I asked the one pastor that was part of that circle, you want a church in the city, but then you're telling me you're never going to make it in the city. Is it me, or is it a church in the city is never going to make it? And of course, you always heard, I think the toes were getting in the middle of their feet, you know, the toe jam, and everything was getting, you know, they're gagging on the big toe, you know, I kind of think. I said, well, explain to me what it is. What it was is because I don't control the ministry out here in the burbs, and you're not in my church, come out of your church, the ministry of, there's no way you're going to be able to make it in the city with us backing you up. I go, that's all. I said, okay. And this happened 20 years ago. Even though I was already in a local church, I was coming out of that church. So, but I am coming out of a local church. That's one of the ministers out of that local church. What are you talking about? You know, they're all like, you know. Because what it was that they said, look, it's going to take lots of money. And you're going to need a lot of workers. And you're going to need a lot of time. And you don't have a staff to do all that stuff. The old asked question, I said, when you started your church here at the first, did you have all that? And he goes, oh no. I go, how many years did it take you to get it? Well, I'm on my 28th year of this ministry here. I go, wow, 28 years to get to that point. Well, I guess I got to get busy, start now. Shut them right off. Can I tell you something real quick? If God is in it, God is going to give it. Amen? Is God still in saving souls? No matter how wicked they are, how much of a sinner they are, how deep of the mire pit they're in, is God still there saving sinners? But the problem is why it's not happening enough is because of us. We become a Calvinist where we start doing selective pickings. Well, he's not predestined. I'm not going to bother with that sinner. Mike knows that one, right? Or, no, can I tell you something? You don't know what God's going to do in the heart of man. But you know what you can do? You can deliver the message to that sinner. You can love up that sinner. You can befriend that sinner and do exactly what God... Remember Luke chapter 10, verse 27? It said, love the Lord with all the heart, the soul, the mind, right? And thy neighbor as thyself. As much as you wanted somebody to come tell you about Jesus, tell you about all that good news, and be delivered from your sins, and be set upon a rock, and live a life of peace and forgiveness, and understand that you're going to heaven. Wow, that was great, wasn't it? So does somebody else. Your neighbor, your sinner friends want the same message delivered to them as someone delivered to you. Please, I encourage you, take some gospel tracts. Invite people to come hear the gospel. Look at the attitude. Turn over real quick, if you could, to 1 Timothy chapter 1. I want you to hear what Timothy's attitude is, okay? 1 Timothy chapter 1. Listen to Timothy's attitude. Now here's here's Paul trying to teach a young man about preaching, right? Was Paul a preacher for the gospel? Here's a man that was a religious man, very educated, was he not? Very well-to-do individual. But listen what he says. Listen to when he finally met the Lord Jesus Christ, how everything was understood in his mind, in his life, in his heart. And he says here in 1 Timothy chapter 1, him teaching Timothy this. He says in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 15, he goes, this is a faithful saying and worthy of all expectation that Christ Jesus came into the world to save what? And look what he says here, of whom I am what? There's no pride, there's no self-righteousness, there's no longer no Pharisees of Pharisees. He's no longer a Pharisee of Pharisees like he was before he got converted. That was fully taken out of his mindset. It was fully taken out of his lifestyle. He said, I'm the chief sinner. He knew that his sin was just as wicked as a woman at the well, as a madman at Gadara, a drunkard man on the street, whatever it was. His sin was just as filthy as any other sinner. Because he said, for I am chief. And he knew that Jesus had is that beautiful or not? So can I tell you something? We need to understand that we need to love our neighbors ourselves. We need to understand Then we need to start looking at things how like Paul is trying to teach this young man like Timothy about the type of heart, the type of attitude, the type of mindset when we go out and talk to sinners that Jesus came to die for. Turn to Galatians chapter 4. We'll close with this. Galatians chapter 4. Galatians chapter 4. Galatians 4. Now look at, he goes ahead, and Paul's telling church here, and Paul, you look at Paul's ministry, did he not go through some stuff? And he did it all for the sake of the gospel. Amen? He put his life first in many areas where he was bitten by a serpent, I mean a viper. He shipwrecked and tossed out of cities and beat up and left for dead and all kinds of stuff. All in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, right? And here in Galatians 4, starting in verse 11, says this, I am afraid of you, lest I have bestowed upon you labor in vain. Brethren, I beseech you, be as I am, for I am as ye are, and ye have not injured me at all. Ye know that through infirmity of the flesh I preached the gospel unto you at the first, and my temptation was in my flesh. Ye despised not, nor rejected, but received me as an angel of God, even as Christ Jesus. Where is then the blessedness ye spake of? For I bear you record that if I had been possible, ye have been plucked out of your own eyes and have given them to me. And I am therefore become your enemy because I tell you the what? The truth. So here's a man that started losing his sight. Here's a man that gave his flesh up to get beaten. He's coming to the church in Galatia and he's being received wrongfully because he's doing what? He's telling the what? The truth of the gospel. Can I tell you, you've got the truth. You might be dealing with infirmities, but listen, you can give truth in love. You can. The way how you deliver the message, right? Anybody here get a pizza delivery every so often? Sometimes you don't even want to eat the pizza the way how Melissa tells it's delivered. How many of you ever go through Tim Hortons? I asked for a sweet tea, right? I got an iced coffee. Those dark, roasted ice coffee, almost choked and gagged on it. And I turned around and went, this ain't sweet tea. This is ice coffee. I didn't ask for ice coffee. They did not deliver the goods right. You know what I'm saying? How you approach people, the sinners, is amazing. When you befriend a sinner that's down and out, you don't become a threat to them. Because you're doing it in love and in peace. When you approach a sinner and you sit there and you get to look at them and their situation and recognize what they're going through. And you sit there and say, listen, see, you're okay? Yeah, I'm okay. You sure? Because you look like you're going through something. Anything I can pray for you about. And next thing you know, you can start talking about Jesus. You're showing more about them than what, more concerned about what you got to be. You're more concerned about what they're doing so you can be a friend to them. Amen? We're missing that today in Christianity. Yeah, but they're always takers, Pastor Pete. All they want to do is get a free hand up. All they want to do is pick your pocket. All they do is they want to mess with you. Take advantage of it. They do it to every denomination. They do it to every place. They go, I know. But you might be the one person to get through to them. You might be the one person to allow them to prove themselves that they're truly looking for help and not a handout. Right? Yeah. Over the ministries, we learn a lot over this ministry, how to do it. If we really want help, that's what they'll come. They'll come to church. If they really want help, they'll come on a Tuesday night. If they really want help, they're going to avail themselves to say, hey, can I get picked up? Can I go? Can I be there? Right? So they can showcase that they truly want help. Amen? We need to get back. Can I tell you, can we start being accused of some things? I want to be accused as a Christian that I'm a friend of sinners. Amen? Isn't that great? Please accuse me. I want to be accused. Excuse me, everything else, but please accuse me that I'm a friend of sinners. I can't believe you deal with all these people. Aren't you afraid of this? Aren't you afraid of that? I go, nope. My kinds of people. Yeah, but they don't know how to conduct themselves in the house of God. Then we get to teach them. Right? I had to tell a couple people not to swear in the church. That's how rough they are around the edge. Like, hey, you're a church. Zip them out. Oh, I'm sorry, Pastor Pete. But only I get away with that. Some other people get, don't you talk to me that way. I can do that. I don't know. Yeah, because I'm a pastor. I don't know. But there's certain people I can talk to. I can talk to. I almost had Biggie in the church for the one day. When we had the thing out, the only kids came in. I go, Biggie, one day you're going to come in. We'll be able to preach to you, Biggie. Not ready yet, Pastor. But we have a good report. Amen? Can I tell you this? This ministry was founded that way. But can I tell you, when you look at churches today, they're full of entertainment. They're full of the big show. They want the big shindig. They want to have fun. But what they don't want to do is they don't want to get dirty. They don't want to get down in the mud. And they don't want to be friends to sinners. One of the greatest attributes that the Lord just tried to show all of his disciples is to help them recognize those people that were hurting. That's why he did all those miracles he did. He went right to them. Okay? He tried to deal with the Pharisees in this crowd. They called him blasphemer. They crucified him. He wanted him gone. But boy, the ones that accepted him hanging around, doing all these miracles and everything, was the crowd that the religious crowd didn't want. And I'm going to tell you something. That's what we need to be. I'd rather sit down next to a drunk and tell him all about Jesus than sit down to a religious crowd, sit there and let them toot their horn how great their church is. Let me read this and we'll get down to our last song. You ready? How we walk with the broken speaks louder than how we sit with the great. Amen? I want to sit around the broken people. I want to sit around the ones that are struggling. I want to sit around those that are struggling. I want to sit around all that.